Terror in the south of France. More than 80 people have been killed and 200 others have been injured. They were cut down by an 18-ton lorry. Many women and children are among the dead. Running for their lives, thousands flee in panic as the attack unfolds.
People were running everywhere, screaming. No one understood what's going on until the gun shooting. On that moment, we understood that it's something serious.
The driver is shot dead at the wheel, but only after causing carnage along a mile-long stretch of road. The man in the cab is now known to be a 31-year-old French Tunisian. And tonight, the British tourists caught up in the chaos say they're lucky to be alive.
All we could think of afterwards was how lucky that we hadn't been involved in it, because as we made our way back up to the promenade, we could see, well, scenes of devastation.
And coming up in sport on BBC News, who's made the cut at the Open Championship? No trouble for Phil Mickelson. He's right up the leaderboard at 10 under par.
A very good evening to you and welcome to the BBC News at 6. We're in Nice, in the south of France, where a major terror attack has taken place. This is the Promenade des Anglais. It runs right along the seafront here, and last night it was a scene of utter chaos and carnage. More than 80 people are now dead after an 18-ton lorry ploughed into crowds of people who'd gathered along a mile-long stretch of the road here to celebrate France's National Day, Bastille Day. Many of them had just enjoyed a fireworks display over the sea. Behind the white barrier behind me there is where that lorry ended up coming to a stop. The front window was shot out by police marksmen when they shot the driver. And tonight, more than 50 people are still critically ill in hospital. We will have the very latest on the investigation. We'll be talking to some of those who are lucky to be alive, having survived the attack. And our first report tonight is from our correspondent, Lucy Williamson. You may find some of the images in her report distressing.
They dared to celebrate freedom and paid with fear. Beach lovers, partygoers, children, hunted with the most mundane of weapons, a lorry. It arrived as the fireworks were ending, crawling onto the promenade before picking up speed and heading straight for the crowd. Its first appearance caught on camera by this man.
Up until this very moment here, the truck actually didn't run over anybody, yet there was a motorcyclist trying to approach the truck, trying to open the door while driving. He failed and he fell off the motorcycle. And then there were two police officers standing right here at that very corner, and they fired two gunshots at the driver of that truck. So up until then, or from that moment on, the rampage took place. Like the vehicle accelerated and ran just in a very odd way right in the middle of the crowd.
It zigzagged for more than a mile through the street party as people ran. Bodies were falling like Skittles, one witness said. Another saw parents throwing their children over fences to try and keep them safe.
The police surrounded the car and they kept shooting him until they are sure he's dead. I saw him dead already. I saw his head outside the window of the truck. And a French police officer, when he saw me standing up and filming, he came to me aggressively and yelled at me to get down, get down. All the people on the beach to run, because I think they thought maybe there is a bomb in the car or something, or other people hiding inside the truck itself from behind. So at that moment, I realized that this is really something wrong, and I started to run with the people.
Un pistolet automatique de calibre 7.65 mm.
In the cabin, there was an automatic weapon, bullets, a Kalashnikov, and M16s, a grenade, a mobile phone that's still being investigated, and various documents.
French officials say the driver was a local man, a 31-year-old French Tunisian known to police for petty crimes. Today, the only figures on Nice's empty seafront were forensics teams, picking their way through the debris of grief.
France was just beginning to feel safe again after the attacks here last year. Safe enough even to come out and celebrate being French. But as people ran screaming down this street last night, the sound of gunfire mimicking fireworks, that moment of national pride and national unity became once again an individual race to survive.
Imad said he froze when he saw the lorry, then ran towards the beach. Above the screams, he heard the lorry's engine just behind him, his path ahead blocked by a bench.
And then when I jumped over the bench, I found myself that I jumped on a woman. She was laying on the ground too. So I just closed my eyes and waited for the crash, neither to crash me or neither to survive. I was feeling that I'm gonna die. I was feeling really, really scared. I didn't know what to do, but I just gave up on that moment. Till I saw the bench breaking up. It was too loud and too scary. So I looked at it and I found it destroyed. So it was really, really close. The thing that was between me and the truck, it was a bench, a small bench.
The French president arriving in Nice today described the attack as a monstrosity. Of the 200 people injured, he said, 50 were hovering between life and death.
We are facing a long battle because we have an enemy who will continue to hit all the peoples, all the countries who enjoy liberty, who put liberty as the essential value.
The flowers blooming on the barricades today mark a particular kind of pain, the slow, mocking torture of French values. Attacks that highlight the price of freedom, the failure of fraternity, and that brutal equalizer, death. Lucy Williamson, BBC News, Nice.
Well, our correspondent Andrew Plant is outside one of the hospitals where some of those who were injured have been taken. And Andrew, many of them are still in a critical condition tonight.
Yes, Clive, of the 30,000 or so people who are watching those fireworks in Nice last night, two main hospitals here in Nice. Now, at the moment, the death toll stands at 84, but we're told...
OK, I'm 50 very others. Sorry for that. We seem to have a few problems with that line to Andrew Plant, so we'll try and get back to him when we can. As we've been hearing, this lorry travelled for about a mile before the driver was killed. It came from that direction and ended up, as I say, behind that white tarpaulin just behind me. And many people are wondering how the driver managed to continue for so long ploughing into people and leaving so much carnage behind. Here's our correspondent, John Donison.
It was supposed to be a night of celebration. It ended in confusion, chaos and carnage. The attack started around 11 o'clock local time as thousands of families strolled home after a night of fireworks. The lorry was heading east along the Promenade des Anglais and picked up speed on a rampage that was to last for more than a mile. Within minutes, the first casualties were reported. The driver began to swerve from side to side, trying to kill as many people as possible. He then careered into the pedestrian area. Armed police opened fire, but couldn't stop him as he continued to plough through the crowd. eyewitnesses say he was travelling at around 50 miles an hour. This is as close as we can now get to the route the attacker took. You can see the Promenade des Anglais just behind the famous Hotel Negresco at the bottom of the street. By this point, several minutes into the attack, he'd already killed dozens of people, and it was to be 300 or 400 more metres that way before he was finally stopped as people fled for their lives. Finally, further down the promenade, using heavy fire, police managed to stop the lorry and kill the driver as people fled in panic. Matthew Schooler from Kingston-upon-Thames had been on what was meant to be a dream holiday with his girlfriend. Today, he knows they're lucky to be alive.
There was a lady in front of us on a scooter with her kids, and she fell over. She wasn't trampled, but people running over her. The kids were upset. People were picking up kids and running, and the kids were crying, as you can imagine. People didn't really know what was going on.
This was not a high-tech attack, but the brutality and the banality of the method make it all the more terrifying. A vehicle used as a weapon of war. John Donison, BBC News in Nice.
Well, one of the British couples caught up in all the chaos was Paul and Rebecca Gordon from the Midlands. They were here on holiday with their 18-month-old daughter. They've been talking to our correspondent, Tom Burridge.
Rebecca and Paul are on holiday in Nice with their 18-month-old daughter, Eloisa May, and they had walked along the promenade back to their hotel just moments before the attack.
And because we're on the fourth floor, I could see pretty much the whole event unravelling, and I just turned to my left and I just saw the whole road was covered in people, and he just accelerated at a faster speed than he had approached the hotel, and he hit everyone. I saw that the truck bounce, which must have been, you know, and I saw people being knocked like Skittles.
You just went, you were grey, and you came running and said, look what's happened. And I came out and there's just people on the floor, just dead.
Today is about coming to terms with what happened.
There was a lot of families there, there was a lot of children, there was a lot of teenagers, I noticed. So you think of, there was a lot of young lives lost, I think, a lot of young lives.
Yeah.
Just sad.
We're safe, you know, everything's okay.
There are phone calls to loved ones back home and reflection about the wider issues at hand.
It's very easy to tarnish one religion for an act which is pure evil. It's nothing to do with religion. This is people that want to get their way and their terror across, and they're just using religion as their tool.
I have to say that coming out into Nice, I admire the people here because everybody's just out in the street and just getting on with life.
Tonight, the last night of their holiday, their hotel overlooks a crime scene. But they know they were the lucky ones. They saw but survived a night of horror in Nice. Tom Burridge, BBC News in Nice.
Well, today detectives have been working very hard to try and find evidence of the killer's connections. Remember, this is the third major terror attack in France in the last 2 years. Our security correspondent Frank Gardner has been following the investigation.
Against a perfect Riviera backdrop, the grisly investigation has begun. French crime scene officers have been piecing together the final moments of last night's attack. And what of the perpetrator, named as Tunisian-born Mohamed Bouhalal? He's believed to have lived in this apartment building in Nice. His neighbours describe his behaviour as odd.
He looked at us weirdly. If we arrived at the building behind him, he would slam the door in our faces. Frankly, not normal.
Police investigators have seized anything that could throw a light on why Bouhalal committed such an abominable act.
Mohamed Laouej Boulel était connu des services de police et de justice He was known by the police for violence and petty theft between 2010 and 2016. He was convicted in March and sentenced by the court to 6 months in prison. But there's nothing to suggest any sign of radicalization.
Only yesterday, during the Bastille Day parade, it was expected that France's state of emergency would be ended. Now it's been extended and 10,000 troops have been mobilized. France is clearly a top target for so-called Islamic State, or IS.
It has the largest number of foreign fighters in the West, in Syria and Iraq, and also the leadership of Islamic State now includes two Frenchmen who have nothing else as a desire than to hit France.
The call to use lorries like this as a weapon against pedestrians was made by IS 2 years ago. Since then, it's established a network of supporters in every major European country. Both MI5, the security service here, and the Metropolitan Police Counter-Terrorism Command are working closely with the French authorities on this investigation. They're looking to see if there's any information that could link the attacker in Nice with anybody back here. The government is also reviewing its safety procedures to reduce the chances of a similar attack succeeding here in Britain. Tonight, the instrument of so many people's death and injury has been towed away. But the question remains, can France's next terrorist attack be stopped? Frank Gardner, BBC News.
Well, leaders around the world have been offering their condolences to the people of France and giving their reaction to what happened here. This is what the Prime Minister Theresa May had to say.
If, as we fear, this was a terrorist attack, then we must redouble our efforts to defeat these brutal murderers who want to destroy our way of life.
Okay, well, with me now is our correspondent, Lucy Williamson. Lucy, this is the third major attack in the last 2 years here. I mean, is there any confidence among the French people that the authorities have a handle on the terrorist situation?
I think the tragedy is that that confidence was just starting to come back in the last few days and weeks. I mean, the November attacks particularly really hit the mood here hard, and there was a sense that people were just waiting for the next attack. Then along come the European Championships, and everyone expects an attack, and it doesn't happen. And so towards the end of that tournament last week, people start to relax. They feel like celebrating again. A few days later, on France's National Day, this happens. And many people, I think, tonight will be feeling they're back to square one. Of course, the motive is very important here. We have to really determine why this attack took place. But I think it has the potential to really set people back.
And there are suggestions that the borders have been sealed in some areas, that extra security is being taken, extra precautions are being taken as a result of this. But as I say, as far as confidence is concerned and the mood of the people here, what is that like?
Well, as I say, I think it's going to take quite a severe knock, particularly if this is confirmed to be terrorism. And President Hollande has been very quick to say, yes, we're reinforcing the borders, we're sending out the soldiers, we're extending the state of emergency. But there's already been some official criticism of the way the security forces, the intelligence services worked in the lead up to the previous attacks last year and in the aftermath of them. So I think there are still a lot of questions that people here in France have about how safe their government can keep them.
Okay, Lucy, many thanks for that. Lucy Williamson there. That's all from Nice for now, but a quick reminder that you can catch up with the very latest developments on our website, including the live page, which has regular updates on it, of course. That's at bbc.co.uk/news. But for the moment, that's it from Nice. Now back to you.
Clive, thank you very much. Theresa May has used her second full day as Prime Minister to visit Scotland for a meeting with the First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon. They discussed the future of the Union as well as the fallout from Brexit. Mrs May said she was willing to listen to options on Scotland's future relationship with the European Union. Our Scotland editor Sarah Smith reports now.
Theresa May's first mission as the new Prime Minister of the United Kingdom is to try to keep that kingdom united. And that means coming to visit a First Minister who would dearly love to take Scotland out of the Union.
The symbolism of this meeting is important. Theresa May demonstrating how much she cares about Scotland remaining part of the UK. But there is substance too. Talks about Brexit negotiations and about Scotland's potential place in the EU.
They both wanted to stay in the EU. Now, Mrs. May has to take the UK out, whilst Ms Sturgeon tries to keep Scotland in. They did agree the Scottish Government can explore different options, and Nicola Sturgeon did bring up the prospect of Scottish independence.
It may be that if we want to protect our relationship with the European Union, then Scotland will have to consider becoming an independent member of the European Union. But I've also said that I want to consider all options along the way, and the Prime Minister has said that this process will be open to considering options that we bring forward.
Nicola Sturgeon says she has a lot in common with Theresa May, apart from their politics, of course, and their views on whether Scotland should vote again on becoming independent.
If the Scottish Parliament were to vote for another independence referendum, would you allow them to hold it?
Well, I think the question is, should there be another referendum? As far as I'm concerned, the Scottish people had their vote. They voted in 2014, and a very clear message came through. Both the United Kingdom and the Scottish Government said they would abide by that.
Some people hope Brexit makes independence more likely. Others want to see if this new Prime Minister can try to satisfy the 62% of Scots who voted to stay in the EU. Intrigued by this early visit.
It's good that she's come up to see us first instead of going abroad. I'm a Union fan, so I'm glad that she's come up here to see us.
It could be a show of solidarity with Scotland, or it could be a kind of power game to you know, make her presence felt here and assert her dominance.
I think she's just kind of trying to sweeten us, trying to keep us all together, trying to not let us go independent.
Theresa May says Scotland can explore different options during Brexit negotiations. But the idea of Scotland trying to stay in both the UK and the EU? One of her ministers today said that is just fanciful. Sarah Smith, BBC News, Edinburgh.
A private funeral has been held for the Labour MP Joe Cox, who was killed last month outside a constituency surgery in West Yorkshire. Hundreds of people turned out in the town of Batley to pay their respects as the funeral procession passed through. An optometrist who failed to spot an eye condition in an 8-year-old boy who later died has been found guilty of manslaughter through gross negligence. Vinnie Barker suffered a fatal build-up of fluid on the brain. He'd been examined 5 months earlier by Honey Rose at a branch of Boots in Ipswich. The prosecution said she should have noticed the swelling. She'll be sentenced later. A man has been arrested on suspicion of making a death threat to the Labour Party leadership contender Angela Eagle. Police say they arrested the 44-year-old man in Paisley, Renfrewshire, after an email was sent to the account of Ms Eagle, who's the MP for Wallasey. It's day two of the Open Championships at Royal Troon in Ayrshire, and the overnight leader, Phil Mickelson, continues to dominate. After his joint world record first round yesterday, the American picked up where he left off with 4 birdies this morning to move to 10 under par. Time to look at the weather now. Here's Helen Willits. Helen.
Rita, it's been rather wet in Troon. It looks drier tomorrow. It's been a rather cloudy day, in fact, right across the UK. You can see the rain up in Scotland and across Northern Ireland. Starting to move into the North Sea now. Just dribs and drabs in the south, really, but cloudy predominantly. And that's the way it will continue this evening, with high pressure close by to the south, very little rain. But some more crossing Scotland and Northern Ireland and moving its way southwards overnight to introduce some windier weather towards the north. Fresher feel here as well. We keep the mugginess, however, in the south, not just tonight, but indeed for much of the weekend. And then our weather front almost grinds to a halt tonight across Northern England and North Wales, and it's there for much of the day tomorrow. So to the south of that, we've got the muggy air and a lot of cloud, misty, murky conditions around the coast and the hills in the west, but gradually some sunshine breaking through elsewhere, we hope, or at least some brightness. And to the north of that weather front, we've got a drier day, as I mentioned, than today, with just a few showers, but the wind will be a bit of a feature, and we've got some fairly heavy showers to come into the north and the west as well. As I mentioned, though, the winds could touch gale force in the north and the west, so that will make for an interesting day at Troon in Ayrshire. So some muggy air around in southern areas continuing tomorrow evening. That rain, as you can still see, meandering its way right the way through the day across North Wales and Northern England, not much east of the Peak District. Now, to the south of it, where the sun breaks out, there could be a few sharp showers, but we may well see temperatures into the mid-20s here. But after today's cloud and rain, I think it'll feel quite pleasant despite the breeze further north. Tomorrow evening sees that rain petering out and trundling southwards, more heavy showers following into the north and the west. So a rather cloudy day in Scotland, parts of Northern Ireland on Sunday. But further south, a good deal of dry weather through the Midlands and East Anglia, drier for North Wales and for Northern England, and feeling warmer as well. Now it's back to Clive in Nice.
Helen, thanks very much indeed. There were many Britons who were on holiday here caught up in the chaos of last night, including Henry and Florence Coath. Harry and Florence Coath were here with me. Thanks very much indeed for joining us. Just take us through what happened last night, because, of course, you were here. You were looking at the fireworks, having a good time.
Yeah, well, we were here watching the fireworks. Like you said, the mood was great. Everyone was happy, jovial. And then it was ridiculous how suddenly it changed and the panic set in. But before that, it was a really lovely evening.
Just take us through that mood shift.
Yeah, so I mean, we'd started to walk away from the seafront where, you know, the firework display was, with lots of other people around us, hundreds of people around us. And really, in about a second, the atmosphere completely changed. People started screaming. That was the first thing you noticed. And then all around us, people started running away from the seafront. And as you do when people around you start running, we began to run. There were parents with children just grabbing them out of their buggies, shoes flying off all over the place. It was chaos.
And you, of course, were running too?
Yeah, we joined with the crowds running, and it really did feel like we were running for our lives. We didn't know what had happened. We didn't have a clue. We just thought, we need to get moving now. We just grabbed hold of each other. We grabbed our mum and dad as well, and we just ran together. And even though we hadn't got a clue, we could only imagine if it was a gunman or a terrorism attack. We didn't have a clue, but yeah, we just started running and tried to get away as possible.
Yeah, I mean, there were suggestions that people were actually coming, the truck was coming from this direction, but people were running from this direction as well. I mean, there was chaos all over. Yeah. You had no idea what was going on?
No, so I mean, we began running, as you say, sort of into town, away from the truck coming this direction. And as we were going into town, some people started coming the other way, and your immediate thought then is there must be another attack happening, which was really the kind of the peak in terms of the terror, because you just feel surrounded, you don't know where to go, you're trying to find somewhere to hide. We ended up going down a side street and through the security exit into a hotel where we were safe for a while. But it's that feeling of you don't know what the threat is, you don't know where it's coming from.
And then when you eventually found out what was actually going on while you were running, your reaction?
It was horrifying. I mean, it all came through in drips and drabs, really. We were calling home, seeing if anything had come on the news yet. There was rumours flying around. Even several hours afterwards, there was rumours that there might be an accomplice on the run, that people had been taken hostage, and we just didn't know what to believe or whether we were going to be safe in the hotel. Someone said, oh, next, the terrorist is going to be targeting the hotel. So it was really a scary several hours. After the initial attack, it didn't relieve.
So what are your thoughts now? You came here on holiday. You've been caught up in this horrific incident. How has it affected you?
I mean, it's disrupted our holiday, but we are the lucky ones because we've got away relatively unscathed. Our trauma is comparatively light to what some people experienced. You know, a disrupted summer holiday in the context of this
is nothing.
We feel lucky.
Did you think you could possibly die in all this?
Definitely. I think we all thought we were running for our lives. We didn't know what was behind us. And at that moment, I definitely thought I could die.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you very much indeed. Well, 3 days of mourning have been declared here. It's a familiar, depressingly familiar, declaration that the president has had to make in terms of trying to bring a country together after such a horrifying event. Now, for all the news where you are, from here in Nice, goodbye.